So the presentation is made very simple. I don't want to go more detailed into Android or any of particular frameworks or something. This is mainly to showcase how we can build Android products easily using TI technology. So that's the theme of this hour, and I'll try to explain like how easy it is to build any kind of Android product with by using TI solutions and TI technology. Okay, next slide is thank you. So first of all, I actually wanted to thank, I don't know if any of DroidCon event organizers are there, but they have really done a good job, so actually I wanted to thank them, but I can convey this later as well. So agenda for today, first let me create the bonding, like the Avatar movie, like first you have to create the bonding when we are talking, right? So the agenda is very simple. As I said, like I would like to introduce you to TI solutions, TI product portfolio, what Texas Instruments actually offers, and how it would help you to build any kind of Android product, and why customers go with Android, like what is the benefit of Android that people use it or are getting influenced to build any kind of Android products, and what is our commitment to Android. And also, like I would be going somewhat in detail about how do you engage with the TI Android open community, and how you can participate with us, and how easy it is to build any kind of products. Later we will have some question and answer session. So hope it's not a sleeping presentation, but still, TI offers solutions, support, technology. So by solutions and technology, there are some differences here. By solution, what we mean is like, it is not like we just offer an embedded processor and for rest of the other things you have to go to some other shop or some other vendor or something. We offer end-to-end solution. I don't know what is end-to-end because both look same points. So it is like if I am starting from software, you get hardware. If you are starting from hardware, you get software. So one end to the other end. So, and also like it is not just, as I said, not just an embedded processor or not just a connectivity solution or not just analog. We offer analog, digital, like as you can see, if you have 3D glasses, you can see like there will be so many chips coming towards you. So like, I don't know. Yeah, you can see the pointer now. So wireless connectivity solutions, power management solutions, data converters, digital signal processing, ARM processors, microcontroller units, amplifiers, analog, RF, and there are tons of other things which TI provides to build any kind of product. So once you integrate all these, you go towards a solution. And then we offer extended support. So I'm not sure how many of you are TI customers directly. Okay, so I think you have to engage with us, then you would come across, or if you would know like the support infrastructure that we have and the kind of support we provide to any of our customers. And then the technology itself, like if you see, we are working on latest and greatest technology, like it could be embedded processing, or it could be analog, or it could be power or connectivity. We have technology which is like up to date, and we are always leading in the front for any kind of technology. From the product portfolio, this is one single slide where I captured entire www.ti.com. So if you go to ti.com site, you would see something like this, where it shows like the kind of applications we engage with. It could be automotive, it could be communications and telecom, computer peripherals, consumer electronics, energy, industrial, medical, security, and a lot of these spaces TI plays a significant role. And then coming to products, like to serve each of these applications, TI has product portfolio to meet all the needs of these applications. And we have a very good support infrastructure in place which will actually help you build these kind of products. Apart from this, like you can buy samples from us, like any day you think you want to build a product, you just request for samples, it would come to you easily. without any issues, and we have a lot of tools and software to enable you to build any kind of product. So please don't mind, I am still going in some kind of selling mode. You should not, I don't know if you are thinking like I am selling more THCM. Okay, but I am just going in little bit of selling mode. So just giving you a brief introduction on what we offer in each of these segments. Like I am not sure if many of you track this, but TI acquired National Semiconductors this year. So with that, we have a huge portfolio of analog. If you are building a product, definitely you would see that this is adding a lot of product portfolio or a lot of solutions to TI's database. So thereby you would get like any kind of analog you would ask for, it would be definitely available inside TI. And there is definitely, we are including somewhere around 45,000 analog products for power and performance and packaging options. There is definitely, again, with TI support plus now national support, like if the support team is definitely huge, and definitely you would get a very broad support infrastructure. And when you go to connectivity, so that was about analog. And when you go to connectivity, TI offers connectivity solutions for various market segments. It could be portable consumer electronic devices or portable medical devices, enterprise, industrial, automotive infotainment, and home consumer. So you just think of any kind of device and TI offers connectivity solution for those. What we cover in connectivity solutions, it could be like few examples are like wireless LAN, Bluetooth low energy, GPS, FM, ZigBee, NFC, and so on. So our connectivity solutions, like we provide whatever is there in the connectivity world today. So we just try to enable each of those. And complete software offering for each of these with reference design are provided for any kind of product development. And these connectivity solutions actually go into some kind of end product. Like a lot of products are already available in the market today, so you don't have to worry about the maturity or of the software or the kind of testing or validation it would have happened. Definitely all of these devices would go into very high volume and very high-end devices. So definitely all the software stack and products are well tested and qualified for any product. And there are a lot of third-party module partners for giving you these solutions. So we covered what kind of applications TI provides or plays into, and then what kind of products TI offer. And then in that, we looked very briefly about analog. We looked into wireless LAN connectivity. And then now we are entering into embedded processors. So this is generally the CPU of any of your product, or it is the heart of, or it is the actual processing power which lies here. So we have in our in TI, like we have various segments or various businesses which actually deal with particular segment. We have OMAP to start with, say, which actually deals with any kind of phone and tablet segment. We have DaVinci series of processors which actually deals with video centric devices. So pictures would definitely will be giving you some kind of idea like what I am talking about. From by video, I mean video conferencing, video surveillance, or digital home video, like HD capability and such things. And there is a Sitara family of processors, which is ARM only, which is mainly used for industrial instrumentation, medical, UI panel, home automation, HMI, and industrial protocols and such things. And then we have MCU segment, which actually deals with 8-bit to 32-bit microcontrollers, which can be used for low-end or low-performance products. So whenever you hear about OMAP, you should think that this will directly go and fit into phones. Whenever you hear about DaVinci, you should think that this will go into video segment. Sitara will definitely go into any non-video, non-phone segment. And then Stellaris is for mainly all the MCU segments. So again, going deep into the embedded processing portfolio, like TI has been, or TI is the first ARM partner who is partnering still with ARM. And we started working with ARM back in 1993 to till date, we have sold almost 5 billion ARM-based products so far. And I think this was the 2009 or 2010 number. Actually, it is 2009 number. I don't know, in last 3 years, we might have sold more than this. So definitely, we have sold a lot of ARM processors. So that means like TI has a very high or rich knowledge or knowledge pool, which is for ARM-based products. And embedded processing portfolio, we extend, as I said, from MCU to non-MCU segment to DSP and ARM plus DSP. So just to highlight here, so we start from MCU segment, which is here, and then we slowly go to 32-bit MCUs and then go into ARM Cortex-A8 and ARM9 applications, and then we go for ARM plus DSP and only DSP applications. And there is also multi-core DSPs. So our processor or embedded processors are arranged in this order so that it won't confuse you. If you are working on anything up to 25 megahertz, you can choose a 430 kind of device. If you want like 440 to 300 megahertz, then you can go to C2000, up to 80 megahertz Stellaris, and then up to gigahertz and more than gigahertz devices, you go like this. So coming back to Android, so the products we enable on Android, as you all know, like TI is one of the big partners or the semiconductor providers for all these top companies, which includes like Samsung, LG, HTC and so on. So we enable almost all tablets today, almost all ebook readers today, and phones and many things which come under phone and tablet segment. Apart from Android for phone and tablet segment, which is the traditional or which is the distribution or software for phone and tablet segment, we also enable Android for non-phone segment or non-tablet segment, which includes point of sale devices, Android appliances, and then Android home phone systems, navigation, automation, and handhelds. So we cover both phone segment, tablet segment, and non-phone and non-tablet segment. So complete range is covered by TI using Android to meet all the product segments. So we all know like how Android is beneficial in phone segment, like the kind of app infrastructure it has created, the kind of ecosystem that it has, and all these. So for non-phone segment also, Android is being considered one of the strong or one of the potential distribution. So some of the benefits to highlight are like the attractive licensing scheme, and then open source software, the infinite ecosystem, committed roadmap, and documentation. So generally the thought process is like, if you don't want to use Android, do you have a choice? Like nowadays we see the kind of products that are coming out in the market, they all have to be smart and they all have to be connected, and they all have to be giving you a user-friendly experience, right? Earlier, if the product was given to you, you would never try to tweak or tinker around the product. Like, if the UI is given to you in some way, you will just enjoy the kind of UI that is given. You will never try to change the UI. But today, you want to play with the device. You want the device to be very interactive, and it should be smart. If it is showing the same screen to you for next 3 years, definitely you would throw that device, right? So you want, every day you want your UI to change, you want your browser to change, you want your media to change, and so many things. So you want the device to be in your hand or your control. So that's one thing that we all are driving towards. So same thing is actually happening to non-phone segment as well. You don't want the device to be like a person who is sitting in some part of the world to define a product, design a product, and throw in your hand and tell you like, use it like this. And here is the user manual and you can't do any changes to it. If you do any change, I'm not giving you warranty or I will not replace the product. If it is like that, then none of us will buy it. Right? So that kind of mode is changed today. So we all want devices to be customizable to larger extent, and then we want the software licensing to be easily usable so that we can put or download any software developed by anybody, so that the infrastructure is more usable. So that is one advantage of Android, why Android is actually penetrating into non-phone and non-tablet segments. Apart from this, like application development language, we all know Java is really much more capable and beneficial when it comes to regular C-based applications. So there is a huge ecosystem already, or there are so many people around who can write Java code and then write the applications based on Java. So all those applications can be used for non-phone segment as well. Yesterday we were talking on another discussion where we told, like, when you are washing your clothes, you want to be playing Angry Birds, right? And when you are standing in front of your refrigerator listening to your wife, you want to be playing chess or something like that. So it could be anything. So range of applications are changing, and you want to be using. We have seen products where, like, kind of cookbook kind of product, like it is a full system, Android system in kitchen. It is very rugged and it keeps reading you recipes based on time. Like it is breakfast, it will give you tons of breakfast recipes. Lunch, it keeps giving you lunch recipes and so on, and which can be used. And same device will get converted to a video phone or video when you want to talk. Same device will get converted to messaging system where you receive SMSs or alerts or anything like that. And same device will actually cater to multiple needs. You don't have to keep a single device for each of those. And suddenly if someone rings a doorbell, this will pop up a video of the person who is ringing the bell, and it will show on the same device. So a lot of such things are happening, and for that kind of infrastructure, you have to build end-to-end software stack. So that is very, very difficult to build. We all know that we don't have time. We want everything ready-made today. No one has time to think or wait for 3 months or 3 years to build a software stack. So Android offers ready software stack which will directly go into any of these product segments. So that is a major benefit why Android is penetrating into all non-phone segments as well. So what's TI's commitment towards Android? We are a Open Handset Alliance member. So I'm not sure how many of you know what Open Handset Alliance membership means, but it is actually formed like around 4 years back or so, where Google and many other SoC providers or semiconductor providers and then the telephone carriers and all joined hands, and they came up with one single framework which can cater to all mobile needs. And TI is the first SoC vendor to actually join the group, and we are actually leading in the front as we have multiple GEDs done or productized based on TI products. So the latest ice cream sandwich is actually productized on TI's OMAP 4. So we have multiple GED devices. We cover a range of technologies and product segments for Android. Like if you all have seen Google Summit last year, so Android is coming up with the home automation, Android at home, or Android ADK, or it could be Android apps or many things. So TI enables not just phones, but TI also enables a lot of these other peripheral segments and other markets that Android is looking into, and also the kind of accessory and peripheral segment that would go along with phones. So having the connectivity solution, having the analog portfolio and all these things, it actually enables lot of other things for Android. So we are definitely committed to Android, and we want to be, as I said, we want to be leading all these Android technologies, and we will definitely be looking forward to close association with Google. For building any product, so just to summarize what are things we have discussed so far, we understood like what is TI's stand on Android, then we understood like what is TI, what are TI's offerings, and then what kind of product portfolio, application segment we deal with, and we learned about analog, connectivity, embedded processing, and the benefits of Android to both phone and non-phone segment. And then we looked into like why, how much we are committed to Android. So looking at the kind of, so when you go build your product, you would look for tools and resources for the same. So we have a range of tools, like starting from $0 to multi-dollar range of tools for you to start exploring any kind of products or design services. So we provide hardware, we provide software, tools. There is a very rich community to support you, and then the support infrastructure that is from TI itself. So just to highlight some of the community development model that we use for Android. So this is just to show you that how actually TI develops or develops Android based devices or starts engaging with Android starts engaging with Android communities. So TI actually clones Android from android.git.kernel.org. This link is no more valid, so there is another link for Android now. So we clone them on our repository, which is hosted on GitOS. We start adding our features and things for our devices, and then we also productize it, which we call as SDK or DevKit. So you can work on cutting edge or bleeding edge by joining us here on our public repositories, or you can actually use our SDKs, which are fully productized version. So if you see, our way of working or the way of Android development in TI is completely open, and we engage with all of these community members or product developers in an open community environment, so that you can participate with us and start developing code for all of your products. So how do we engage with the TI Android community? You choose a platform. It can be like our regular SDKs or something, or it can be our open TI Android communities like AeroBoard or PandaBoard or BeagleBoard. And then you participate with us in IRC and discussion forums. Like, there are IRC and discussion forums for each of these platforms. And then there is a TI E2E community where every E2E is like engineer to engineer community. Like, whenever you post something, it directly reaches us who are in the R&D domain, and then we respond to your queries. So it is that open for anybody who is developing the products. And there are a lot of open documents which are available for you to refer on processor.wiki.ti.com and Omapedia as well. So you choose a platform, join the discussion forums, read the documents that we have already provided, and then you can definitely go and build a product. Okay, so I'm not sure how many of you would definitely go and build a product, but we are almost ready, or we are committed to enable you and support you in building any of your dream products. If you are a student, I think whatever I was talking was all like flying off the head. So if you are a student, then definitely we love the student community a lot. We enable every year lots of students on TI tools and technologies. So there is definitely a easy access to all the technologies that we develop in TI. We give, or there is also a forum that we give to students to express or to come and showcase their talent or their solutions that they have offered, which will be directly visible to the global community or professional world that we would call. So just to give you an example, which I just took this Google analysis just few minutes back. So from in just 1 month, BeagleBoard has around 186,000 visits for that portal as such. And then AeroBoard has around 15,000 visits per month. And then if you see, like, each of these countries that we all know, like, they have so many visits if you list it through countries, they have so many visits. So if, for example, if you put a video on BeagleBoard.org, you can definitely see like so many people will be watching your video. And assume, like, if you have come up with a solution or something which is really killer, and if you are putting just here, it reaches infinite. You can't even imagine like how much its reach is. Okay, so these are the things which student community can really leverage and actually contribute or come and collaborate with us and explore or get the visibility that they are actually looking for. Okay, so I actually completed before 10 minutes to give more room for question and answers to keep the session interactive. So if you have any questions, we can take up, or else we will be there in our stall or the hackers corner that we have set up here to give you all a hands-on expertise.
This is related to one of your slides about you can run any C++ application on top of Android by using NDK libraries. Yeah. Whether any limitations are there for that? We can run any kind of C++ application there? Because I know that Android is using Bionic C instead of GLibC or something like that.
So recently we also found that normal GCC applications can also be integrated. Like you can have some regular GCC applications also that can be interface. But it all depends like at what layer or what level you want to use those applications. Like say I can actually have dual file system, one file system which is totally built out of BusyBox and with a different tool chain, and I can boot over that file system and then mount Android file system. There are multiple ways of handling C++ applications. So one is using NDK itself, which is like using Bionic library and Android provided tool chain. You can write C++ application, but still you will be limited to Bionic libraries. That is one way that you are talking. And also there is other way around, which you can use regular tool chain and other libraries to have it interfaced with Android application. But again, it depends. It results into like high memory and all such issues. Like you have to load both the libraries and all those things. But if you are okay with the memory size and all, you can try those things.
My question is regarding multi-core processes evolution. How many cores are going to be feasible as such possible, and what are the energy constraints are going to be tomorrow with a multi-core if we talk about the handheld devices in context of handheld devices?
I think it is a trend now that everyone is doing control C, control V. So copy one core and paste one core, copy one core and paste one core. I don't know how much of that will be really efficient. And when you consider the software and applications itself, but definitely there is lot of effort going on in creating multi-core infrastructure. TI, we are planning for quad-core, and we have already announced those things already. So ARM is also investing a lot in multi-core infrastructure. So definitely if you see from ARM, from TI and many SoC vendors, you see like there is a huge demand for multi-core SoCs or the processing requirement. Like everyone, like earlier, just 3-4 years back, we had processors which are like 300-400 megahertz. Today we are talking about 2 gigahertz and 3 gigahertz kind of devices. But still we want to keep increasing those things to maximum. So definitely there will be more multi-core devices, and software also will see its, like there will be definitely a lot of evolution happening in software as such to support those multi-core domains.
What are the challenges you face due to the software development in a multi-core environment? Because mostly what we have seen now, IT industry or whatever developers are there which are passed from the institution, they are coming from the CEO.
So you are saying like what are all the challenges that we are facing in enabling multi-core?
Yeah, currently they are coming, almost everybody is coming from serial programming paradigm, right? Very, very few people are really, have a skill set with the talent. So I would really like to understand what are the challenges you people are facing in terms of the talent pool, as well as the software architecture, not only that, the tool plus architecture wise, and adjusting whatever the libraries already existing in a, which are coded for a serial architecture, and then you have to port into a parallel architecture. You know, how the things are you people are, how you people are managing all this tool.
Yeah, it is going from segment to segment. Like as I showed you, like we have multi-core in mobile space and multi-core in backplane or communication space, where we have like 10 core DSPs and things like that in one single chipset, and like multi-core ARMs and all in like base station and such things. So for that particular base station segment, the way we are handling software is totally different from the multi-core segment that we are handling in the mobile space. Okay. From challenges point of view, like we had very, we were looking. So one good thing for us is like multi-core is not new in Linux infrastructure itself, because Intel and others have been working with multi-core for so many years. So when we enter into multi-core, like we are not the new people to enter into it. Linux is already powered to handle symmetric multiprocessing and other things. So the basic core itself is, when you run basic core Linux itself, it is good for multi-core processing. But the challenge is actually not for us, but the challenge is mainly from the end product manufacturer who actually wants to ensure that all cores are actually getting exercised or used seamlessly or properly in an order, so that the CPU load is distributed. So actually they are spending more time trying to understand, we are enabling them or helping them. But from the basic port as such, like Linux kernel as such, almost we are ready to support any kind of multi-core processing. The challenge for us is mainly in the framework layer, when you are actually implementing multimedia processing, or when you are actually implementing this 3D graphics acceleration. So all these things need a standard framework to be in place. Today what we are doing is that initially we were writing our own frameworks to support such kind of multi-core or asymmetric multi-core kind of devices, right? But then we slowly moved to standardized frameworks like OpenMax, OpenGL and such things, where we know how to handle those kind of asymmetric processing and symmetric processing in a much better way. So it all has been like hidden from actually the user layer or the application layer itself. So most of them actually will go into the frameworks that we are actually deploying. Thank you.
Okay, we'll give a round of applause for Mr. Khasin for his